Welcome, guys. You guys know I've been on this Bible challenge. This is the third day of the Bible challenge. And for those who are not aware, I started the Bible challenge last year and I didn't finish it. And one of my sisters from the academy, one of the moderators, she was saying like she goes back on YouTube just to see the Bible challenge, to see if she can receive a word. And it really just touched my heart to know that somebody actually go back on the YouTube channel to watch the Bible challenge. And so I've been saying since day one, you never might know who you're impacting. You never might know what your encouragement is doing for someone. And so I moved to start over the Bible challenge from square one, and we're on day three. Day one was about trust. Day two was about faith. And day three, as you can see from the title, beware of false prophets. Now, this, I didn't plan this, y'all. I had a whole different, I'm laughing because God is really comical. I always tell you guys, I don't like to come live, and I was kind of really getting in my comfort zone by going live in the FAR Academy. For those who don't know, the FAR Academy is a private women's group where we focus on building courtships and marriages amongst our women. Teenagers are in there, married women are in there, single women are in there, and we truly just pour out our hearts to God. And so many things have been going on in the FAR Academy. We've had two engagements so far, God bless. We've had people that's been healed and delivered. I'm excited about what's going on in there, but I believe that the Academy really just kind of gave me that comfort zone area. And so God has brought me out of comfort zone once again. So now I'm doing the 30-day Bible challenge, and this is day three, y'all. I'm so uncomfortable. I really don't want to do this. The word that I had for today was not beware of false prophets. And then this morning, God gave me this word, and I said, well, God, if you want your people to hear this, then I'm going to go ahead and come out of my comfort zone. Also, this word is to encourage those who believe that God have called them. Call them to speak, call them to minister, call them in this season and this time to speak on his behalf. And so I pray that you will be encouraged. I pray that you'll be enlightened. I pray that you will be moved. I pray that you will not leave here the same. I pray that there's a seed that will be planted within you that creates a shift, a seed that will grow and will manifest good fruits. Hi, Lady Angelica. Good to see you, my dear. Good to see you. All right, I was telling them, Angelica, I really don't like to go live, but you know, as you know, God just loves to put us out there, out of our comfort zone. I'm telling you guys, when you're in the presence of God and when you're doing something for God, you can never be comfortable. The moment you feel comfortable is the moment God gives you a shift, and this is my shift. And as I encourage you guys, I'm literally encouraging myself, because as I read this morning and God was just speaking to me, I was encouraged, and I'm going to go ahead. If you see me looking on the side, that's only because I have my iPad here. And I'm going to show you guys that literally, like, I can't speak unless I'm encouraged. And so God was just speaking to me, and I wrote this right here, and I just want to read it. I really just want to talk to you guys today. I want to get intimate with you guys today. We get intimate with God in this hour. I said to God, I wrote it here on my tablet, in these times and days, help me God, in these times and days, my thoughts and prayers are, I do not want to be lost, and I do not want to be a false prophet. I don't know, can we have a talk? Is anyone out there that may be watching now or maybe watch afterwards? Have you been having these thoughts? Because I've been having these thoughts lately, now that we are in the last days. Like, It's no longer that perilous times is coming. We're now living in perilous times. And so because I know that we are living in perilous times and we're preparing to see our King, okay, I've been thinking so often, Ruth, you cannot allow this world to cause you to be a false prophet, because I've been seeing so much falseness amongst the churches, amongst the saints. I'm here on social media, and I've said this in the academy, and I've said this to some of my friends. I am afraid almost to scroll down on Facebook because of the things that are so unreal that our people are soaked into. It's like this generation, some of us don't know God for ourselves because we've been holding on to the things that our mothers taught us, the things that our church or pastors and our leaders have taught us, and we have not held on to the undiluted word of God ourselves by reading God's word. And I'm so happy that God sent me to Edmonton, because honestly, Edmonton, Canada is not a comfort zone for me. Honestly, I don't know what God is doing in my life, but all I know that I am not in my comfort zone. And because God sent me here in Edmonton, I realize that I've drawn even closer to God. I realize that I'm digging even deeper into God, in his words, understanding and knowing who God is. One of our admins in the FAR Academy, she's also from Edmonton, Renee, she said the same thing. Coming on this side of the world, you really begin to understand who God is, who the love of God is. It's amazing how God can move you and reposition you so you can understand and you can know who he is. And so we're out here, I said, in the bush, in the wilderness, out of her comfort zone. And wow, I'm gonna reread this. I said to God, in these times and days, my thoughts and prayers are, I do not want to be lost. I do not want to be a false prophet. And then I said, I don't want the crowd if the crowd doesn't want the truth. I don't know about you guys, but I refuse to be amongst a crowd that just want to hear what they want. If they want to hear what they want, I don't want to be amongst them. And so I said, God, I don't want the crowd if the crowd doesn't want the truth. Because in these days, people just want pretty things. People don't want to hear the truth. People don't want to change. People just want the things that make them feel good. People just want sweet stuff, candy stuff. Can I tell y'all that the truth, we always say in Jamaica, or we always say this, that the truth, it hurts. But my husband always say, no, Ruth, the truth sets you free. And because of that, because people don't want the truth, because they don't want to be set free. They don't want to be set free. I want you to think about that. That's the reason why people, they want to be at a church where they can just do what they want to do, wear what they want to wear, go where they want to go. They don't want any kind of guidelines, no kind of guide. Their pastors can't say much, else they're going to leave and be offended. I'm telling y'all, this live feed is for you. Whoever is coming in here and have that spirit, I pray that that spirit be shifted in here. Shifted in the name of Jesus Christ. So I said, I don't want the crowd if the crowd doesn't want the truth. And I believe that the church and the pastors and the leaders, this should be your motto today. I don't want the crowd if the crowd doesn't want the truth. Because you see, a lot of ministers, teachers, preachers, they want a packed house, a packed church. Can I tell you, a packed house and a packed church comes with big problems. It comes with big problems. And so that we find that when you have these big churches, when you have these mega churches, the truth ain't being preached. What's being preached is purpose. What's being preached is prosperity. Because the people don't want it. They got itching ears. They don't want the truth. So God, I don't want that. That's what I told God. I don't want it. And then I said, I grew up hearing the truth of Jesus Christ in my house. And it shall never depart from me. I don't know if anybody out there have the same sentiments as me, but this is just what I wrote to God. And I'm just sharing this with you before I go any further. And then I said, too much false prophets walking around fooling the saints. It's scary in these times. So many churches have swayed from the truth. Don't be fooled. Not because they lay hands and heal makes them true people of God. I'm going to say that. Not because you go to a church or you're in a church and they lay their hands on you and you're healed. It does not make them true. I'm telling you, even the elect, we will learn in the further scriptures, even the elect will be fooled. Be fooled by their giftings. Be fooled by what they're doing. Don't be fooled. It's time for the people of God to be alert. I'm going to go in 2 Corinthians, because after I wrote that to God, that was just like me and Daddy Jesus' private time, intimate moment. After I went private with God and just telling him and writing this down, God sent me to this scripture. Okay, 2 Corinthians 6:13, and it says, wherefore, and I pray that I could just talk to y'all today. I don't want to be wild up. I just want to talk to y'all today. I want to talk to somebody that feels like how I feel today. I want to talk to somebody that's dying for a change today. I want to talk to somebody that aspire to be a pastor today. I want to talk to somebody that aspire to be an evangelist today. I want to talk to somebody who aspire to speak the word of God and the unadulterated word of God today. This message is for you. And so 2 Corinthians, God spoke to me, and I love God. I love him so much. When I was writing the book, Designed to Be a Wife, and I had moments where God would just speak to me, and sometimes I may not understand, and this was a moment when God spoke to me. And God said, 2 Corinthians 6:13, wherefore come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. I don't know if you understand. Let me repeat that scripture. Wherefore come out from among them. See, many times we use this scripture for those who are not in church, those who are unequally yoked and all that stuff. But this scripture is also for the believers. Okay? So wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. Then God gave me Matthew 7, and I got Matthew 7 on a whole nother level than I used to get it before. That's what I love, the word of God. Hi, Tashaya. Hi, sweet girl. I love seeing my far sisters here. Thank y'all so much. I love y'all so much. But as I said, Matthew 7, I got a whole vision, different vision from Matthew 7. And Matthew 7, I'm going to start from 15 and I'm going to read to verse 20. It says, beware of false prophets. And we're going to learn about some characteristics of what it is to be a false prophet. Okay? So Matthew 7 says, verse 15, beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are raving wolves. I'm going to read it again because that's what I love to do. If you guys know anything about me, I went to do my master's only because I wanted to be a professor. I have one class to finish, haven't finished it yet. But that's the only reason why, because I want to be a professor, because I love to teach. And so that's why I'm always repeating and I'm always repeating. So 15 says, beware of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are raving wolves. Ye shall know them by their fruits. How do you know a false church? You will know them by their fruits. How do you know a false leader? You will know them by their fruits. How do you know a false teacher and a preacher and a prophet and a prophetess? You will know them by their fruits. As the scripture says, ye shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? No. Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. That's why I don't understand. How do the people of God, your vision is closed, your vision is locked, you can't see, you're sitting down in a stagnant, dead church with full of false prophets, full of false prophetess, full of false leaders, teachers, and you can't grow. You're like, I can't grow. I can't get my breakthrough. Aren't you seeing? Y'all, it doesn't take an angel to come from the sky to understand this is what's going on. This is what I'm living in. This is the church that I'm in. It doesn't take a fire, okay? The word of God is true. The word of God is light. The word of God is always clear. That's why I always say to the Fire Academy, and even in my book, Designed to Be a Wife, the characteristics of love from Corinthians 13, it's plain. It's plain. God's word is plain. You're saying, I don't know if he loves me. What is the characteristics of love? Go right back there to Corinthians 13. And so this is plain and straight as God showed us. Even so, every good tree beareth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree beareth forth evil fruit. Even so, verse 18 says, a good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bring forth not fruit, good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. Wherefore, by their fruits ye shall know them. That part always stick out to me. By your fruits we shall know who you are. So how is that the people of God are sitting down, not growing, sitting down, can't get their breakthrough, sitting down in uncleanness, as 2 Corinthians says, wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. Because you're in a church that's unclean. You're in a church where the doctrine has been wavered. You're in a church where they're giving you the sweet stuff. That's why the people are not set free. Mighty God, wherefore by their fruits ye shall know them. Characteristics. We're going to go in some characteristics. I love the fruits of the Spirit, y'all. I love the fruits of the Spirit. You want to know that your pastor is real? You want to know that your leader is real? You want to know that the church that you're living in is real? This is what I live by. I even check myself by this. Everything that I'm saying to you, I've already said it to myself and keep reminding myself. And characteristics. This is what we're going to check is a characteristics. I feel like a lot of times we, the people of God, we go into church and we really don't apply the word of God. We really feel like we need to hear this from some big person out there, when everything that we need is in the word of God. These characteristics is the characteristics of a true preacher, a true officer of God, a true agent of God, a true vessel of God. It goes right back to the fruits of the Spirit. Galatians 5:22 verse 23 says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. Now we're going to go into the works of the flesh, because we're going to test these character. Because I still don't understand. How is it that we have false prophets all over Facebook? How is it that we have false prophets all over YouTube? How is it that we have false prophets all over Instagram? And some of y'all are going to their conferences. Some of y'all are going to their churches. Some of y'all are feeding day in, day out, day night on their stuff. On their stuff. And you're wondering, why am I still the same? Why am I not getting a breakthrough? Why am I not changing? Why am I not being delivered? Because you're under false shit. You're under false shit. So you will never be delivered. You will never be changed. Characteristics. How to know that somebody's false. The works of the flesh. The works of the flesh. It's plain. It's plain. Mighty God, amen to Shia. Everybody quiet in the house. But it's all good. It's all good because I want to talk to y'all today. I want the people of God to wake up. Wake up. Wake up. Because I can't scroll down on Facebook no more. Because all I'm seeing is the saints. They're dwelling among fellowship. They're all up in the prayer lines. Not realizing that these people are sifting you away. They're swiffing you away. They're taking away your money. They're giving you all the stuff that you want. That's going to make you smile and happy. And they're not going to tell you the truth. Why? Because they don't want to lose you. And y'all up in their churches. Ridiculous. It's so ridiculous. Works of the flesh. Galatians 5:19-21. And I'm going to go in the definition of some of the works of the flesh. Because a lot of times we don't realize what these works mean. Now, I'm going to start from verse 19. Now the works of the flesh are manifested, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness. Remember the scripture that God brought me into? 2 Corinthians, that says, wherefore come out from among them and be ye separated, except the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing. So one of the works of the flesh is right here before our eyes: uncleanliness. Lasciviousness. The meaning of lasciviousness is arising sexual desires. Mighty God. Idolatry. The meaning of idolatry is excessive or blind adoration, reverence, devotion. I put here worship. They've become worshipers of their own selves. You ever been in a church? All the pastor is doing, all the leaders are doing is worshiping themselves. I've seen it all over Facebook. If it's not about them, then it's nothing at all. But yet you still tune in. You're still watching them. You're still liking their posts. You're still commenting. You're still dressing up, raising your children up in these churches. But all they care is about themselves. They don't care about you. They don't care about your generation. They don't care about your life. They don't care about your growth. They don't care about you making it into heaven. We need to start getting radical saints and get up out of those false ships. Mighty God, idolatry. Idolatry is one of the biggest things because they worship themselves. And it's plain and it's straight. So how can you not see it? Another work of the flesh is hatred. We already know what hatred means. Variance. Variance is disagreement, quarrel, dispute, controversy, discord. A lot of the churches suffer in this area. It's constant discord amongst the brethren, constant discord in the organization, constant discord. There's no unity. There's organizations out there, and I've said this to one of my friends, that God had me to study. About the scribes and Pharisees. And I was so amazed. I should have went live on it, but I didn't. I'm not going to lie. Because I was afraid. I was like, why is God telling me all these things? And through the revelation of studying the scribes and Pharisees, I realized that a lot of these organizations, that's what they are. They are scribes and Pharisees. But yet the children of God are sitting down in them for years. For years. For years. Scribes and Pharisees. Wow. Other works of the flesh. Emulation. Emulation is efforts to desire to equal or excel others. Copying and mirroring. For those who know my story, I've been going through some of that craziness. I'm telling you, a lot of the believers in the church, they need to get it right. Their characteristics, they are false. Their ministries are false because they don't have this distinction about them. They want to be like somebody else. They want to be a TD Jakes. They want to be a Juanita Bynum. They can't have their own identity. That is a work of the flesh, and that's how you know somebody is false. Mighty God. Another work of the flesh, wrath. We know what wrath is. Another work of the flesh is strife. And strife, let's get into the meaning of strife. Strife is one of the hugest thing. I put one of the biggest one in the church. I'm telling y'all, strife is disunity. Disunity, it's a dysfunction in our churches. And we're in some of these dysfunction organizations. There is no unity. One organization or one part of the organization say you can wear this. And the other part of the organization say you can wear that. And then the other part of the organization say, do what your pastor says you could do. And the other part of the organization, they don't have it together. Dysfunction, disunity. There's nothing. There's not one rule, not one rule, not one guideline. There's just this disunity. But yet we sit down in these churches. We sit down in these churches and we're not seen. Why? Because the word, I'm telling y'all, God's word is life. God's word is truth. God's word is everything that you need. Yes, when your pastor talks to you, it's good and all. But go deeper, because he also got to go deep. He also got to know God for himself. He also got to keep an account for himself. So you also need to keep an account for yourself and your relationship with God. See, too many of y'all are living that surface life. So y'all are easy blown with the wind. Y'all easy swaying. Y'all worshiping y'all bishops and pastors more than how you worship God, more than how you get in the word of God, more than how you get in relationship with God. God is calling y'all back to relationship. God is calling y'all back. Go read from the Genesis and straight through. I've been on a journey, y'all, and I'm still on a journey because I ain't gonna rush the process. I want to know God for myself. I don't want nobody to come tell me that this is what God says. Yes, that's fine and dandy, but I need to know Jesus Christ for myself. How many of y'all have the zeal to know God for yourself? See, too many of y'all, you're all about the vanity. The other day I was reading the entire Ecclesiastic, and at the end of the day, what? Keep my commandment. At the end of the day, gone away with vanity. All of these things are caught up in TV shows. That's not going to do any good. We're caught up in the things of the world. And that's why when a breeze blows, you're gone. You're gone with the wind. You're gone with the storms of your life. Because there's no substantial foundation. There's no relationship with God. When you're sitting down in these churches and you're worshiping these prophetesses and these prophets. The mighty God. Oh God. Jesus, help me. Wrath, strife. Sedation, one of the other works of the flesh, is disobedience. God had me to write. God want you to know, a lot of them walk out of covering. A lot of y'all walk out of your church. Go back to your pastor. Go back to the church that birthed you. A lot of y'all left your church and talk about y'all pastors and apostles and bishops. Go back in the name of Jesus Christ and go make it right with your pastor and go make it right with the bishop and go make it right with your spiritual father in the name of Jesus Christ. Coming out of covering. That is what God wants you to know, because what? You're wrapped up in sedation. You're disobedient. But if we all know the scripture says obedience is better than sacrifice. Another work of the flesh is heresies. Heresies, it means any belief or theory that is strongly at variance with established beliefs and customs. And this really ties into sedation. Because of the disobedience and y'all done left under y'all covering, y'all done brought the spirit of heresies, and you guys have churches that are heresies churches. You guys are falling away from the doctrine, falling away from the Godhead, falling away from the oneness of Jesus Christ, falling away. And then all of these people are following you. Y'all better know God for yourselves. Know God for yourselves. Other works of the flesh. Mighty God. Envying. Envy means, and I'm going to talk about it, although we know what envy means. We all know what it means to envy, but I'm going to talk about it. We won't talk about it. Envy means a feeling of discontent or covetousness with regard to another's advantages, success, possession. Envy is to backbite. A lot of envy going on in the church amongst leaders. Envy means to covet. Mighty God, a lot of envy is going on amongst the organizations and the leaders. Envy is to hate. Some of y'all hate this organization, hate that organization. And y'all leaders, envy is to lust. Envy is to malice. Envy is to spite. Envy is opposition. Mighty God, I might just have to just leave it right there. Another work of the flesh is murder, drunkenness, reveling. I'm going to go there. God gave me a whole other revelation on reveling as a work of the flesh. Anointed Nelson says, sis, that's where I'm at, getting to know him for myself. Lord, I don't want to be a false prophet. Amen. Amen. Reveling. Reveling is often revels an occasion of merrymaking or noisy festivity with dancing, masking. God hit me with something so strong when I was reading this, y'all, and I didn't even know if I should be saying it, but God gave me the go ahead, and he hit me so strong, y'all, because when we think about reveling, we think about carnival. When we think about reveling, we think about party. As we hear, the meaning of reveling is an occasion of merrymaking or noisy festivity with dancing and masking. A lot of the churches get involved with these masking things, with mass banquets and all of that. That is the obvious. But God showed me the unobvious. And I know that some of y'all, God already revealed this to you. But God showed me, I wrote in brackets, church conferences. Church conferences. I said, God, are you serious? Why are you having me to write church conferences? And God was basically saying to me, I'm showing you how reveling applies in my church. Because a lot of times we apply it to carnivals. A lot of times we apply it to the world. But the church is also reveling. And so he had me to write church conferences. And he brought me back to Amos 5. And Amos 5 says in verse 21, it says, I despise your feast, and I will not smell a sweet odor in your solemn assemblies. This word, it really shook me up this morning. I was very uncomfortable to be able to like bring this to you. I didn't even want to come on here with this, because I was like, God, your church is really a part of reveling other than the obvious? God is saying from Amos 5, I despise your feast, and I will not smell a sweet odor in your solemn assemblies. Now, this is Jesus Christ dealing with the children of Israel. And we know the children of Israel is a depiction, is a pattern of the church of the living Jesus Christ. And so God himself says, I despise your feast. I will not smell a sweet odor in your solemn assemblies. You're mean, God. You're telling me that some of these assemblies stink? That's what you're telling me, God? In verse 23, take thou away from me the noise of thy songs, for I will not hear the melody of thy vows, which means harps. You mean to tell me that God don't even want to hear your songs? Some of these churches stink so bad. Some of y'all false prophet churches out there that's swiffing away God's people. God already done away with y'all. God don't want to have nothing to do with y'all. God don't want to hear your singing. Some of these churches, they're really high in the singing. Their music ministry turned up, as we would say in modern language. Turned. That's how people are being won to come to their churches. Their choir is so good. But you mean to tell me, God, that their choir stink? You mean to tell me, God, that they're musicians, you don't want to hear them? You don't want to hear them play the harp? You don't want to hear them play their instruments? Mighty God, I don't know if somebody is getting this, but the Holy Spirit within me, it is shaking me up to see. If you thought it was me, here it go. It's in the Word of God, how God dealt with the children of Israel when they were walking out of alignment with him, when they took up these false idolatry and false things, mighty God, when they forsake Jesus Christ, when they forsake the truth. Wow, God, have your way. Wow. Jeremiah, I'm in ending. This was supposed to be a Bible challenge with just one verse and me just remind you of the verse, and this is what God is doing. And I say, God, well, if you want me to do this, then just have your way and whatever it is that God needed to do in this Bible challenge. Obviously, it's not just for me. It's for everybody out there. God brought me back to Jeremiah 23:16. This is what the Lord Almighty says. Do not listen to what the prophets are prophesying to you. They fill you with false hope. They speak visions from their own minds, not from the mouth of the Lord. Some of them prophets talk about bring money. Which prophet you see? Which prophet you see talk about in the Bible, bring money? Y'all need to go back in the word of God. Enough of y'all churches talk about bring money, sow seed, do this, do that. Go back in the word of God. If you read from the word of God from the beginning, you will see how God built his house. You will see that the people willingly came and brought the things for the house to be built. I'm not even going to go there. I'm just saying, I'm not going to even go there. Y'all need to go read the word. Matthew 24:24, for false messiahs and false prophets will appear and perform, keyword, not minister, perform great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect. I believe that even the elect, I'm seeing it more and more. I scroll down on Facebook, I've seen some of the elect people that I respect highly. They are being deceived. They're being deceived because what? The false prophet will appear according to Matthew 24:24 and perform great signs. All y'all, some of y'all saints, y'all only move when there is signs and wonders. I'm telling you, you need to start trying the spirit and try your own spirit. Don't be a child of God that only move when the Holy Spirit move. Don't be one of them child of God only when the ruckus and the shamas happen. That's when you move. No, try the spirit and know God for yourself and know when there is a false spirit. That's why all some of y'all, you guys are being tricked and deceived. 2 Timothy, and I'm going to end with that. 2 Timothy 4, y'all, I didn't want to stay on here this long. 2 Timothy 4, we're going to read 3 to 4. Actually, 3 to 5, and I'm going to end it there. I really pray that this blesses somebody. I really pray that it blesses somebody and it awakens the people of God. So you will not be deceived. Shakira says, that's right, sis, not biblical. Amen. Tashoya says, oh my, for years I'm having trouble accepting this sowing seed. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. 2 Timothy 4:3-5, it says, I charge you in the presence of God. I want y'all to listen to this. I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is the judge, the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching. We're in that time right now. But having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passion. That's why you have some of the false churches. They only invite these false preachers and prophets and prophetesses because they will preach what they want them to preach, because their ministry is false. So they're not going to preach the truth, which will set the people free. So as you see, for the time is coming when God will not endure sound teaching. The people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions and will turn away from listening to the truth. Wander off into myths. They wander off into lies, and we're believing those lies. As for you, always be sober-minded. For those who are passionate about God, for those who God has handpicked, you've been on a journey. Some of y'all ministers, I love y'all. Y'all, I love you guys. I watched y'all preach when I was a teenager, young adult, and y'all still preaching. Some of y'all fall and came back and still preaching. I love y'all because God handpicked you. God called you out. But I don't want you to sway from the truth. Don't go to every and any assembly. Don't do it. Don't do it. God loves you. God called you out. And he called you out because he knows that you are able to do this. He can trust you. And I should ask this question. Can God trust you like how he trusts Job? That Job was an upright and righteous man. As for you, always be sober-minded. Endure suffering. Some of y'all preachers and teachers, you're falling from the truth. pastors, because you don't want to endure suffering. But we are in the time of suffering. If people gotta leave your congregation because you're preaching the truth, let them leave. In Jamaica, we always say, I learned this in school, that one sour grape will spoil the whole bunch. Let them leave. Cut the bad fruit off. As for you, always be sober-minded. Endure suffering, that long-suffering, that fruit of the Spirit. Do the work of an evangelist. Fulfill your ministry. I want to say, all pastors, preachers, leaders in your church, I want to repeat this for you. This is for you. This is for you. I pray that your spirit will be awakening, that you will turn away from falsehood. If you're in there and you've recognized that you've got mixed up with falseness, that you shouldn't have been a part, it's not too late. Get out of it. Cut out some of those friends. Cut out some of those ministries that you're always going to. Cut out some of those leaders that you're always talking to, because all they're about is the money, getting money for people healing. Where in the Bible do you see people giving money for healing? Where? Robbers. Saints, do not be fooled by the enemy. And so I want to repeat this to the leaders and the pastors and the ministers out there and the churches out there and the saints that are here with me and will watch this after. As for you, always be sober-minded. Endure suffering. Endure it, church. Let's endure it together. Let's hold each other's hand. Let's walk in unity, church. When the world knows how to walk in unity, why is it that we're suffering in the church? Why are we suffering in the organization? Why can't we hold each other's hand and build together? Why can't we come together and storm the gates of hell? Why can't we come together and teach this world who Jesus Christ is? Why is the world is the one that's teaching our children? The world is the one that's showing unity. The world is the one that's doing a whole bunch of collaborations in modern day language. And the churches can't even unify to have a conference. The church can't even unify to have a conference so that the people can be set free. Because what? Pastor so-and-so don't believe in that. Sister so-and-so, the secretary, da-da-da-da. No, unity. We're too divided. Go repeat it in y'all hearing again. 2 Timothy 4, verse 5. As for you, always be sober-minded. Endure suffering. Do the work of an evangelist. Fulfill your ministry. God bless you all for joining on this Bible journey with me, this whole Bible challenge. God bless y'all. I pray that the seed will fall on good ground, that you will bear fruits, good fruits. May God bless y'all.